Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Wal Aqibatu Lil Muttaqeen Was Salatu Was Salamu Ala Sayyidil Anbiya Wal Mursaleen Sayyidina Wa Nabiyina Wa Karimina Wa Shafi'ina Wa Mawlana Muhammad Wa Barik Wa Salim Wa Salli Alayhi Rabbana Zidna Ilma Wa Razukna Fahma O Allah, increase our knowledge and grant us understanding Rabbi Yassir Wa La Tu'assir Wa Tammim Bil Khair Wa Bika Nasta'een O Allah, make it easy for us. Don't make it difficult. We're asking you for help, Ya Allah. Sallallahu ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammad bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. I greet you with the universal greeting of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are alive and present here for another episode of the Sunni Path. Inshallah, today would be the last time that we would discuss this book, Evidence for the Visitor, that Muslims are not grave worshippers. We are going to continue from what we spoke about last week. Last week the question was, is it permissible to kiss the railings or to kiss the grave of a saint, a wali, or of a nabi? And we spoke first about the Hajr al-Aswad, the leader's stone, how the Prophet ﷺ kissed it, how he gave attention to it. And then we spoke about how Rasul ﷺ kissed Imam Hussein. And then we made the analogy between that if you cannot kiss the Hajr al-Aswad, then the Prophet ﷺ said, put your hand on it and kiss it. And if you cannot do that, then put your stick on it and kiss it. And if you cannot do that, then just show a sign that you are greeting the stone and kiss your hands. And for Sayyidina Hussein, the same thing, that if you cannot kiss him, then kiss his blessed grave. If you cannot kiss the blessed grave, then kiss the railing around it. But we will prove it further, inshallah, that this kissing is only out of love. It's only out of tabarruk, out of seeking blessings. It's only about expressing our love for this saint or for this Nabi. We get nowadays, this one group of people, the Wahhabis, they claim that everything is bid'ah and haram. So they say, when they speak of anything, bid'ah, shirk, haram, these are the three terminologies which they mainly use. So when it comes to kissing the graves of the Anbiya and the Awliya, they immediately put fatwa on you and they give a verdict and they say that you are a mushrik, you are a grave worshipper, you are worshipping the grave by kissing it. So we say to kiss is not an act of worship, but it's an act to express love. Today we are going to speak about the Holy Kaaba. And with this point of the Holy Kaaba, we are going to show the comparison between the Kaaba and the Awliya Allah and the Anbiya Allah. Starting off, we will say we kiss the Kaaba for barakah. What is our proof? Because we cannot use anything just based on logic, no. We base it on the Holy Quran and Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Qadi Shawkani, he was a great muhaddith. And he mentioned a chapter called in his Nailul Awtar, chapter about entering into the Kaaba and taking barakah and taking blessings from it. Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu, a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I entered the Kaaba with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat down. He praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He glorified Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after a while he stood up and whatever was facing in front of him from the walls of the Kaaba, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam then placed his chest. He placed his hands and he placed his cheeks against it. So Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed his blessed chest and his blessed cheeks and his blessed hands on the wall of the Kaaba. And then Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made the takbir. He said Allahu Akbar. And then the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made the tahleel. He said La ilaha illallah. And then Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua. So while Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in this position with his chest and his face and his hands held against the Kaaba, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thereafter, he done this with the four sides of the Kaaba, with the four corners or the four walls of the Kaaba. And then after that, he came out. This is mentioned in Nailul Awtar and mentioned in Musnad Imam Ahmad and in An-Nasa'i. Second hadith. After we explain the second and third hadith, inshallah, we will then give the points to be noted from there. Second hadith is Abdul Rahman bin Safwan. He said, when Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam conquered Makkah, at the time in the occasion of the conquest of Makkah, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came, Safwan went away. And after a while, he came and he saw that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out of the Kaaba, and the companions, they were greeting the Kaaba. And how did they greet the Kaaba? They placed their cheeks against the walls of the Kaaba while Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in their midst. Qadi Shoukani, he says, this is clear, 100% evidence that it is permissible to place your cheeks, your chest, your hands on all sides of the Kaaba and to make takbir and to make tahleel and to make dua. So what points do we take from this two ahadith that we mentioned? Number one, to place the face and the hands on the Kaaba, this is actually a sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's not shirk and bid'ah. Look in the days of Hajj nowadays. I'm not talking of a grave of a wali, no. I'm not talking of a grave of a Nabi, no. I'm talking of the Kaaba itself. In the days of Hajj, you would hear that the Wahhabis, they are promoting on their channels that to hold the corners of the Kaaba, to touch the Kaaba for tabarruk and for blessings, and to make dua while you're holding the Kaaba, this is shirk and this is not allowed. This is not allowed. They tell you that it is not a sunnah. And here we just prove that it is a sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we can see what is the devious acts and the devious ploy. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was educating his companions how to take tabarruk. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he educated the whole ummah that by being in the close proximity where Allah's blessings are descending, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكَ, that in Makkah, Mubarak, it is a blessed place. Allah's blessings are descending. Then the Prophet taught them, in the place where there is blessings, we must make dua. And we learned this concept previously when we spoke about Sayyidina Zakariya alayhi salam. He was in the close proximity of the saint of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he made dua. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told us in his actions, when he was holding the Kaaba and he was making dua to Allah at the same time, that it is not shirk, but rather this is a means of acceptance and a means and a method of making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to hold something blessed and then to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. From this we say, likewise are the graves of the Anbiya and the Uliya. If you are holding it and making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you hold it and you're kissing it only out of love and seeking tabarruk and blessings from it, it can never be shirk. And we have to know that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that the awliya Allah and the believers are greater in honor than the Kaaba. Let's take this evidence what we are speaking of. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was making tawaf. He was circumambulating the Kaaba. He was going around the Kaaba. And then the Prophet said, how beautiful is your fragrance, O Kaaba? How great is your honor? I take oath, in whose hand is the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the honor of a believer is greater in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than your honor. And we do not think concerning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except good. This hadith is mentioned in Ibn Majah and Shu'ab al-Iman and Ibn Abi Shaybah, Tabrani, in different kitabs of ahadith. Then we look what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he says that I narrate from the Prophet ﷺ, that the Prophet said, how great are you and how great is your honor, O Kaaba? But surely a believer has greater honor in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than you. This hadith is mentioned in Tirmidhi. And this hadith is a Hassan hadith. It is an authentic hadith. So when we put these things together, we look what Imam Ghazali mentions. He says a hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, surely Allah honored and dignified the Kaaba. But if a slave, if a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to demolish the Kaaba and he has to take it out stone by stone and then burn those stones of the Kaaba, it will not reach the crime of one who insults a chosen servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can understand how great is the honor of the believer in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nowadays we get those people who claim that no, they have to destroy the graves of the awliya. They are actually insulting the awliya Allah. And anyone who seeks war against the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he seeks war against them. Man adali waliyan faqad adhantuhu bil harb. The hadith is in Bukhari, hadith Qudsi. Allah says, whoever seeks war against my friends, then I seek war against him. What we are proving here is that there is so much honor and so much respect for the Kaaba and we're allowed to kiss it. So in the same way with Dalalatul Nas, to understand it with a higher purpose, that it would definitely be allowed to kiss and to touch the graves of the Anbiya and the Awliya, because they are more honorable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's go to the fatwa of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. What does he say regarding this? He says, kissing and touching the blessed graves of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the awliya Allah to express love. It is to express love. Once his son says that, what if, oh my father, someone comes and they ask us, why do you see that there is no problem with kissing the grave of the Anbiya alayhi wasallam, of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? So Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, he responded and he says, because we did not see Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the companions saw Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam with their own eyes. They experienced the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly. They kissed his actual hand. They nearly fought over the water what Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam made wudu with, what touched his body. They even distributed the blessed hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the day of Hajj. When any saliva came out, they took it and they put it on their faces. They love Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam so much. Since we have not had the fortune of sharing in this love of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we touch his grave as a mark of commitment and reverence and a mark of acceptance. This is why we kiss it. So we are kissing it out of our connection to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Imam Ahmad says, did you not see Al-Thabit al-Bunani? He was the companion of Anas radiallahu anhu. Whenever he saw Anas radiallahu anhu, he used to kiss his blessed hand. And why he kissed his hand? He says that I'm kissing your hand because this is the hand that touched the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was kissing it out of love, out of blessings. He used to take the tabarruk and he used to show and express his love by kissing the hands of Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So he says, Muslims today, due to their tremendous love for Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Allah has ordered that we must love Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered us that we must love him, these people, they love Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than their own lives. Once he mentioned this, it is clear for us that we are allowed to kiss the blessed grave of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imam Ahmad even says that it is allowed to kiss the pulpit of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he stood on. And he says that it's even allowed to kiss the place where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to place his blessed hand on the minbar. I want to show you. Now, this was understanding from other hadith and analogy. I'll show you directly where a companion placed his face on the grave of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once it was during the time of Marwan bin Hakam, And Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, he comes to the blessed grave of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he is very emotional out of love of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he places his face on the blessed grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Khalifa comes and he says, "What are you doing?" And when he comes closer, he sees that it's Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So he responded, "I did not come to a stone. I came to visit the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam." And then he responded and he told to the Khalifa, "I heard Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, don't cry for the ummah when someone qualified is ruling the ummah, but you must cry for the ummah when someone unqualified is ruling the ummah." This hadith is mentioned by Imam Hakim and Imam Zahabi. He says this hadith is sahih. What points do we learn from this hadith? Number one, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, he clearly shows that he came to visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he never come and visit just a grave. He never come and just visit a stone. He's clearly saying that I came to visit Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he never come and visit the makan, the place, but he came to visit the makin, the person who is resting there sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This was his love. Number two, he was showing that don't think the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is dead. I am coming to visit Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Marwan, he understood that no, Abu Ayyub, he is kissing the stone or his face is on the stone, so he is doing something incorrect. He was implying that Abu Ayyub was doing something wrong. So Abu Ayyub told him, don't cry when someone qualified is ruling the ummah, but cry when someone unqualified. He also implied back that, listen, you are unqualified. How can you judge me? How can you put such a fatwa, such a ruling upon me? So nowadays we have to cry. Because the Wahhabis, they are unqualified to rule Islam, and they carry on. They are a small minority, but they have very loud voices. Everything is bid'ah and everything is shirk and everything is against Islam. So we have to cry for the situation of the ummah. And it's because of them that people are becoming extremists and becoming radicalized. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from them. Take another example. Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu. After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he left this mundane world. After Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu, Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu, he left Medina. After a couple of years, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam came in his dream and he says, "Oh Bilal, why are you avoiding me? Why is this absence so much? Why are you not coming to visit me?" Immediately Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu, he came and he left where he was and he came to Madinatul Munawwara. Because out of his extreme love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he went to the blessed grave of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he became so emotional that he began to cry and rub his face on the blessed grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And none of the companions objected. Ibn Asakir, he mentioned this, and Imam Zahabi, he also mentions this. When we look at it, he placed his face on the blessed grave of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when someone goes and touch the grave and or kiss the grave or place his face on the grave of a Nabi or a Wali, then this is actually part of the actions of the companions and the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In conclusion, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he says, benefit from these hadith what we mentioned and these fatawa what we mentioned, some deduce from this that the permissibility of kissing all the corners of the Kaaba. And this also proves the permissibility of kissing everything that deserves respect, be it a human being or not a human being. Listen to Ibn Hajar's words. This gives permissibility to kiss everything that deserves respect, whether it is human or not human. Is for kissing the hands of human, it's simple. The permissibility came to us from the Muslims, and we can find it in the chapter of manners. But kissing other than human beings, also has come to us, it's also transmitted to us. Some people say, no, maybe this is weak, but I, Ibn Hajar, says that this is sahih and this is authentic because Sayyidina Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, his son, narrated this narration directly from Imam Ahmad. So he was saying, some people say this fatwa of Imam Ahmad is not authentic. But Ibn Hajar says, no, it is authentic. A Meccan Shafi'i scholar said, it is permissible to kiss the Holy Quran and parts of the Hadith and to kiss the graves of the pious people. End of the quote. So we can see this was the Aqeedah of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah for centuries. Only the Wahhabis came now and they make everything bid'ah and shirk. So to place your face on the grave of the pious people out of love and to seek tabarruk and to kiss it and to touch it is totally allowed in Islam. And this can be understood from the actions of the Salafus Salih and from the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The final chapter of this book is regarding the adab and the manners of visiting these graves. There are a few etiquettes which we have to pay attention to, and when we go to the graves of the awliya and the anbiya, we have to show this type of respect. Number one, our intention. We are going to visit these graves for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to act upon the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says, Zuru al-kubur, visit the graves, for innaha tudhakkirukum al-akhirah, because it will remind you of the akhirah. When you enter the graveyard, you should greet all those people who passed away, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us in the hadith of Sahih Muslim, Assalamu alaykum ya ahl al-diyar, peace be upon you, O inhabitants of the abodes. When you enter, enter from the direction of the feet, if possible. Why? Because there are narrations what mentions that you should enter from the direction of the feet. Give special salam to the person you came to visit. Like how Sayyidina Ibn Umar used to go and he used to stand at the blessed grave of Abu Bakr and at the blessed grave of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, and what he used to say? Assalamu alaykum ya Abu Bakr. Assalamu alaykum ya Umar. So you can go, and all the fuqaha, they also taught us that you should give a specific greeting. Once you are there, you may place your hands on it, you may kiss it, you may make dua, however you want to greet and take tabarruk. And when you are making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Ask Allah to forgive you and to forgive them. As Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made dua at the graves. He said, Nas'alullah lana wa lakum al-afiyah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and pardon us and to pardon you. And then after that, when you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Allah through the wasila. Ask Allah, oh Allah, I ask you through the wasila of my good action of coming to visit your friend. So to go and visit the waliullah or to go and visit a grave is a sunnah of the Prophet. So with this sunnah of the Prophet, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your dua. You are in the blessed proximity, so you can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your duas. Then we go forward, don't ask the wali. Don't say, oh Shaykh, give me this. Oh wali, give me this. Why? Because this is metaphorical. This is istighatha. It's a total different topic. It needs to be understood correctly. Otherwise, some people can misunderstand it and they can misinterpret and misconstrue what you are saying. So what you have to say, you have to make dua through the wasila, because this is very simple for us, all of us, to understand. After this, you may put flowers on the blessed grave, you may take, maybe put chadars, cloth to honor the wali. And when they put these chadars and these cloths, you can take it for blessings. The poor people, destitute people, they may also use it. Females are allowed to go as long as they don't go against the sharia in any way. No one should go and circle and circumambulate and make tawaf of the graves. You shouldn't disrespect the grave by stepping on it or kicking it. You shouldn't say words which will displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you shouldn't make noise there. And the important thing is, if the grave is in front of you, don't make salah towards the grave because it's makruh. But make salah maybe on the side of it, or make sure the grave is behind you and you make salah. And this is based on the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, where Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he saw Anas bin Malik making salah facing towards a grave, and he told him, he never commanded him to repeat that salah. But he just said al-qabr, al-qabr, and said now Anas, he went forward and he performed the salah and the grave was behind him. From this, Ibn Hajar says that it is makruh to perform salah with the grave facing in front of you, because the Prophet prohibited it, and the prohibition of the Prophet can be because it's haram or makruh. And we proved that it is makruh, and this you can find in the books of fiqh. And before departing, finally, you should greet the wali and then depart in a sensible way, with a way of respect, of making ziyarah of the grave of this wali, and take a lesson from him that you want to become close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you want to change your life, and you want to be good, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and give us guidance according to the Holy Quran and Sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.